Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much for joining us today. My name is Lindsay Trapp. I'm a senior associate in Dechert's Private Funds Group, and I certainly know that I see a lot of ERISA matters coming up in my practice day to day, but I'm very lucky that I just get to dial an extension and get one of the three gentlemen who are joining me here today, Drew Oringer, Steve Rabitz, and Aryeh Zuber in our ERISA team. We in the Private Funds Group here at Dechert have noticed that there's certainly quite an uptick in getting ERISA money in fundraisers for private funds, so we thought that it would be helpful to get our ERISA colleagues here to provide a refresher and an update on ERISA for all of you. So with that, I will turn it over to Drew Oringer.
Yeah, thank you so much, Lindsay. This is great. Really happy to be part of this group, and I'll just sort of be essentially moderating. I'll be chiming in here and there, but this will be mostly for Steve and Aryeh. And then we'll also weave in Lindsay as well. I want to take several steps back and begin with a little basic context. There might be varying levels of familiarity with ERISA, and I always like to start with the notion that ERISA, really like benefits legislation around the world generally, is a reactive statute. It reacts to problems that are perceived or that happen. Lawmakers tend not to pass pension and benefits legislation just because it's a good idea. Usually there's a crisis or there's a scandal or both. On the fiduciary side, which is what's relevant here, there was a concern back in the day about real carelessness with people managing, quote, other people's money, if you will, and frankly, theft and dishonesty. Some of the early Teamster debacles going way, way back, decades ago, really revolved around employee benefit plans. There's a lot of money there, and it can sometimes be tempting for people to misuse that money. And I think this is a key point here because, you know, since ERISA is by its nature remedial, sometimes you'll see ERISA overshooting the mark. And I think you're going to hear some of that today. It may go overboard a bit. But I want to caution, that doesn't mean that the rules don't make any sense at all. There sometimes is a knee-jerk reaction that something is just incomprehensible completely. But really, when you stop and try to understand what they were trying to do and where they went overboard, maybe it's more understandable and maybe it's less incomprehensible. But still, sometimes they do go awry and they do go overboard, and we'll see that. I think it helps to understand this context and also to understand that a lot of the ERISA rules are not fully developed. There's a lot of lore, L-O-R-E, as opposed to law, and so sometimes what you're left with is talking to ERISA people about what they think that the results are. Another point of reference here, sort of the why are we talking about ERISA at all? This is, except for the people on that are presenting, this is generally speaking not a group of ERISA people. Why are we talking about employee benefits? And the reason is, as many of you know, that a large portion of the available investment capital in the world is in pension plans governed by ERISA. Employee benefit plans are not just regulated programs that are complicated and all of that. What they are is they're essentially quasi-investment funds that have a whole lot of money. And they basically are holding that money really to do two things, pay benefits and invest. Unlike operating companies, pension plans really have nothing to do with their money other than pay benefits and invest. And also these plans, these trusts grow tax-free so that they're growing even faster than their taxable counterparts. So that when you hear that, you know, company X or company Y is in a deal, is in a fund, is in a transaction, I would venture to say that in a large percentage of the cases, maybe even up into the high 90s, you're not talking about company X or company Y. You're talking about the company X pension plan or the company Y pension plan. And these pension plans may well not only be major players in the global markets, the global capital markets, but even the major players. The pool of ERISA assets has been called the biggest lump of money in the world. And if you go back enough years, what people would say is, you know, this ERISA stuff is very complicated. Let's just say that ERISA plans can't invest. We don't want their money. Well, I think that time is long gone, and I think that now what you're seeing is people saying, let's at least get the ERISA money in, maybe to the extent where we don't have to worry about all the specific ERISA rules. And that has now evolved, I think, even further to where people are now saying, hey, even if it requires us to really toe the line and really understand what it takes to comply with ERISA and to understand and sort of manage the risks, we want to really accept ERISA money, maybe even without limitation. And I think that's the context we're in. I think before turning it over to Steve, I mean, Lindsay, I mean, is what I'm saying consistent with what you're seeing when there's fundraising and the like?
I certainly think so. We're definitely seeing a number of people that previously would have limited the amount of ERISA money coming in, considering becoming, you know, a plan assets fund or something along those lines. And actually, Drew, one question for you. We see a lot of state pension money coming in as well from the likes of CalSTRS and NYSTRS. Those aren't technically ERISA plans, so is there nothing that we have to worry about with them?
Well, it's a really interesting point. When you're talking about these public plans and non-U.S. plans that come in, sometimes, particularly on the U.S. public side, they either have rules that are similar to ERISA, or whether or not they have those rules, they want to be treated like their ERISA plans, because sometimes, frankly, they don't even know what their own rules are, and they figure that if you're satisfying the fully developed ERISA rules, that's got to be good enough under the local rules. So even where you've got investors, employee benefit plan investors that aren't subject to ERISA. Again, examples being state plans, U.S. public plans, and even sometimes non-U.S. plans that sometimes look to ERISA-type thinking. You're still going to be worrying about ERISA by contract, even where ERISA doesn't apply. So that's a really great point. I think with that, I'm going to turn it over to Steve now to start us off on really the substance. That was really just sort of setting the table. And Steve, now over to you.
Drew, thanks very much. And thanks for everybody for joining. Drew mentioned before that it's important to know why we're talking about this. Clearly, there's loss of assets, the biggest lump of money out there. But it's also important to know that ERISA contains some of the most punitive rules at law. It ain't going to be a great day at the office, unfortunately, if you've got an ERISA violation. It's not a great day at the office for any violation, but ERISA in particular. The reason for that is that you got a lot of contractual and legal impediments to doing business sort of the way that you want and not having, you know, these terrible penalties that could apply. The first is there's a rescission rate. If you're engaged in a transaction that is a prohibited transaction, you have to make the plan party whole for losses. Generally speaking, each transaction is looked at separately. And so you have to look at each, and in many cases, for purposes at least for the prohibited transaction rules, which we'll talk about in a little bit, no real netting. In addition, if that's not worse, because nobody likes to have a Damocletian sword over their head with a put right, essentially, there's excise taxes of 15% of the amount involved for each year, or for each part of the year, the transaction's not corrected. Now, on the next slide, which I'll show you in a second, the IRS takes the position that certain continuing transactions, with a continuing transaction, a loan, for example, any kind of debt, is really deemed to be entered into anew each year that the transaction is outstanding. Before I turn to the next slide, there's also other whammies like civil and criminal penalties, equitable relief, and something that's often lost on people is that individuals as well as companies have personal liability for fiduciary breaches. Now, of course, those are the legal issues, but I don't want to give short shrift to reputational harm. After all, everybody is, you know, looking to keep AUM and have a good reputation. Nobody wants to have ERISA violations on their, you know, on their dossier. And of course, there's been an uptick as well in class action lawsuits. So I mentioned how excise taxes work. It's bad enough that they're 15%. It's bad enough that they're 15% per year a prohibited transaction is outstanding and uncorrected. But in the context of a single continuing transaction like a loan, the IRS, which has jurisdiction on the excise taxes, actually applies it in a way that is somewhat of a cascading effect. So I have an example here, which you can look at your leisure, where there's just one single loan that's entered into in 2020. And you don't discover until 2025 that, in fact, the loan was prohibited. Nothing's changed, just one loan. And you can see that the excise taxes rack up very, very quickly even though that it's just one signed document, one loan takedown. Now, we talk about ERISA being, you know, a big lump of money, prohibited transactions, but, you know, it's also not easy. And although Drew has mentioned before, made it clear that, you know, it's there are internal consistencies within ERISA, a lot of people have difficulty with ERISA. And, you know, if you find yourself in that position, you're not alone. For example, Supreme Court Justice Breyer, I've always been, you know, fascinated, actually mentioned in oral arguments that he is confused. And it's on something basic. There's something basic about ERISA that he's not understanding. Well, that just illustrates the fact that there are a lot of difficult rules, and don't try this at home. Always consult, you know, your favorite ERISA lawyer to at least help you through the process. Drew, I wanted to hand it over to you again because we've been talking about ERISA and ERISA assets, but maybe it might make sense to talk a little bit about, well, you know, what are ERISA assets? Is it just the XYZ pension plan? Does it have to have the name plan in it, or does it go beyond that?
Yeah, I think that's a great point. So Steve just went through, you know, the taxes that can apply. In the ordinary case, when they do apply, you're talking about people who are facing ERISA plans. You know, people are so that when you're out there managing ERISA assets, and somebody's facing you, they're very worried that you may have ERISA plan assets and that if you do, that you're not fully in compliance, because guess what? If there is a non-compliance problem, the party dealing with the plan, the counterparty to the plan, may have the kinds of liabilities for excise taxes that Steve was just talking about. There actually are circumstances in which the ERISA managers can have that liability too. But in the most circumstances, you're talking about the party facing the plan. And so you say, well, okay, so that means be careful when you're facing a plan. That should be a fairly easy question, right? Well, it's not. And this is a big point. This is the, quote, plan assets question. When are you dealing with plan assets? When does ERISA apply to a vehicle? And you would think that that's an obvious, easy question. If I'm talking to the A company pension plan, then, well, gee, I guess I'm talking to an ERISA plan, right? And I guess I am. If I'm talking to the blankety-blank trust company as trustee for the A company pension plan, then yet again, obviously talking about ERISA assets, right? Well, sure, these are obvious cases, but not always so obvious. Let's do an example here. Let's take sort of an extreme case where a pension plan just drops all of its billions of dollars of assets into a holding company and takes back 10 shares of Holdco, of the holding company. And let's say that the plan then argues, takes the position, well, my plan asset, the asset in which I'm invested in, is 10 shares of Holdco. That's the thing that ERISA applies to. All of the Holdco assets, those are just assets of some corporation somewhere, a corporation named Holdco. Well, I think even if you hate ERISA, even if you don't like ERISA, that seems, I think, a little bit too cute. I think most people would say that you should not be able to avoid ERISA simply by dropping all of the trust assets into some corporation and then taking back 100% of the shares of the corporation. I think that's sort of an easy example. But now let's go to the other side of the coin. Let's say that the plan invests in some large company somewhere that makes computer software or whatever, and buys 10 shares of that company. Well, should that cause the assets of the company to become considered assets of the plan? Now, let's go back to the first hypothetical. If you decide that when you're investing in Holdco, sort of what I'll call the look-through Holdco, and keep that word in mind, look-through, what you're basically saying is that every asset, the billions of assets that you move down into the Holdco, should still be considered all to be held in the trust. If I did that when I bought 10 shares of an operating business, if I moved all of the operating business's assets into my pension trust, I'm not sure I'd be able to operate. The ERISA rules that we're going to hear about in the second half of this presentation are very onerous, very difficult, and from an operating company perspective, very unworkable. These rules were meant to regulate fiduciary conduct. They were not meant to let operating companies operate. And so what the Department of Labor has done here is they've not surprisingly said, when you invest in an operating company, the assets are going to be just the shares of the operating company that you bought, but not all of the shares underlying the operating company. So again, the holdco scenario, you take 10 shares of holdco back, you're invested in holdco, you're also, for ERISA purposes, deemed to be invested in all of the assets that holdco owns. Other side of the coin, you invest in an operating company, you own the 10 shares of the operating company, but you're not considered to own all of the assets that the operating company owns. Obvious examples on both sides. Here's the problem. What about everything in between? What do you do with things that are not so obviously looked through and that are not so obviously not looked through? And here's that case where the Department of Labor maybe goes a little overboard here. What they say is, for everything in between, if you can't find an exception under the rules, you do look through and you do have ERISA apply. Okay? And what is it that's in between? The things at either end? What is it that's in between sort of the abusive holdco and the operating company? Well, of interest to people on this call, it's investment funds. That's what's in between. And so what the result is then is that if an investment fund can't find an exception to the plan asset rules, that maybe ERISA applies to that investment fund. And maybe that's okay and maybe it's not, and we'll talk about that later, but that's the basic setup. And so when is it that ERISA will not apply? And that's where the rules take effect. And now I'm going to throw it back to Steve and to Aryeh to walk us through the details of how these plan asset rules work.
Thank you, Drew. It's Aryeh here, and I'm going to talk about the exceptions to this plan assets look-through rule that Drew just described. So to restate what Drew had just stated, under the plan assets regulation, which was originally promulgated by the DOL in 1987, when an employee benefit plan acquires an equity interest, and that's an important point, it's an equity interest in an entity, and the equity interest is not a publicly offered security or a security issued by a registered investment company under the 40 Act, the plan's assets will be deemed to include, as Drew said, both the equity interest that's acquired and, more importantly, the undivided interest in the underlying assets of the entity into which an interest was acquired, unless an exception applies. So as Drew mentioned, this is the look-through rule because effectively we look through the fund and now the assets of the fund are deemed to be the assets of the benefit plan. Now, once these assets are considered to be plan assets, they become subject to a variety of ERISA's rules and obligations. Fortunately, as Drew mentioned, there are some exceptions to this look-through rule, and those are the ones that are listed here on this slide, and we'll talk about them in detail in a moment. These exceptions remove the taint of the fund becoming plan assets and becoming subject to ERISA. So to list these exceptions, there's the mutual fund exception, the publicly offered securities exception, the operating company exception, and the operating company exception includes VCOC and REOCs, which we'll talk about, and the under 25% exception. That's the insignificant investment exception. All right, I'm going to advance to the next slide, which this slide lists a number of different types of investment vehicles that can be affected by the look-through rule. And you can see it's a pretty extensive list. So anytime you're dealing with one of these types of entities and the entity receives an investment from a benefit plan, you'll need to make sure that you satisfy one of the exceptions that we just mentioned. Otherwise, your fund will become subject to ERISA. So you can see that the list is quite broad and includes a wide variety of investment vehicles. This next slide is a good graphical representation of the two paths that you can take if your fund decides to accept ERISA money. You can either attempt to avoid being covered by ERISA, and that's the top half of the slide. And in order to do so, you're going to have to utilize one of the exceptions that we just discussed on the previous slide, or you can accept that ERISA will apply to your fund and you'll have to comply then with the various obligations that ERISA imposes. This next slide shows the possible exceptions that are used for particular fund strategies. Some funds are able to rely on only one type of exception, while others have multiple exceptions to choose from. So for example, a private equity fund will generally rely on either the BCOC exception or the under 25% rule, while the publicly traded REIT will rely on the publicly traded exception, and a mutual fund will rely on the mutual fund exception. So let's go back for a moment to slide 9, where we had listed the various exceptions. Before we dig into the specific requirements of each exception, generally speaking, think about why we don't want to have our fund become subject to ERISA. As Steve will discuss in more detail later, individuals or entities with the discretion to manage and control the fund's assets, or those individuals or entities that provide investment advice with respect to those assets, will be considered ERISA fiduciaries to each of the plans that invest in the fund. And ERISA fiduciaries will need to act with the highest standards of care and loyalty. Further, transactions entered into by the ERISA-covered fund and the compensation arrangements of the investment manager or the general partner of the fund will become subject to the prohibited transaction provisions of ERISA and the code and their associated penalties and taxes, which Drew had referenced earlier, and Steve is going to go into more detail momentarily. So as we discussed, an investment by a benefit plan in a U.S. registered mutual fund will not cause the mutual fund to become plan assets. Similarly, an investment by a benefit plan in a publicly offered security won't cause the public company to become plan assets. In order to constitute a publicly offered security, the security must be part of a class registered under Section 12B or 12G of the 34 Act. It has to be freely transferable and widely held. One important point to note before we move ahead. The plan assets look-through rule applies, as I mentioned, only to equity investments of a plan. There is no look-through rule when a plan invests in a true debt instrument. This is why you'll see with regard to securitization trusts that only certain classes of those trusts are permitted to be sold to benefit plan investors. These are the debt classes, and oftentimes they'll get a will-be debt opinion from the tax attorneys on the securitization. A plan's investment in the debt classes won't cause the securitization trust to become subject to ERISA. The equity classes, however, may cause the trust to become subject to ERISA if they're held by benefit plans. And therefore, it's extremely important when dealing with a securitization vehicle to monitor the equity classes to make sure that the trust is able to satisfy one of the exceptions to the look-through rule, or that there is at least a prohibited transaction exemption available for transactions involving those equity classes. Okay, now we're going to go speak about the specifics of the two bottom exceptions that are listed here, the operating company exception and the under 25% test. And those are the ones that are used most often when dealing with hedge funds, private equity funds, and the like. So I'm going to advance now to slide 13, which specifically addresses the BCOC exception. If a plan invests directly in an operating company, as Drew had mentioned earlier, ERISA does not look through the operating company to cause the operating company's assets to become subject to ERISA. So what is an operating company for purposes of the plan assets regulation? When don't we look through the company and cause its assets to become plan assets? So an operating company is a company that's primarily engaged directly or through a majority-owned subsidiary in the production or sale of goods or services other than the investment of capital. But the regulations take this one step further and allow funds to function through an exception called the BCOC exception. So not only will a plan's direct investment in an operating company not taint the assets of the operating company, but a fund that accepts ERISA money, think a hedge fund that takes ERISA money, and that invests and operating companies can, under certain conditions, not become subject to ERISA. This type of fund is referred to as a VCOC, a venture capital operating company. An entity can qualify as a VCOC if, on the day that the fund makes its first investment, its first long-term investment, at least 50% of the fund's assets valued at cost are invested in what are called venture capital investments. A venture capital investment is an investment in an operating company in which the fund has direct contractual management rights. So at least 50% of the fund's assets have to be invested in these types of venture capital investments as of the date that the fund makes its first investment. The fund also must, in the ordinary course of its business, actually exercise these management rights with respect to at least one operating company, and it has to devote substantial resources to doing so. A fund has management rights, these management rights that we're discussing, if it has direct, and that's important, direct contractual rights in the operating company in order to substantially participate in or substantially influence the management of the operating company. And the fund has to have its own direct contractual rights. Contractual rights, management rights that are shared with other investors will not qualify as acceptable management rights for purposes of the VCOC exception. And some issues that relate to VCOC restructuring include first day issues and wind down issues. What do I mean by first day issues? If the VCOC makes any non-qualifying investment before it makes a qualifying investment, it can never qualify as a VCOC. So it's very important for the fund sponsor to make sure that the first investment is in a qualifying investment. Another issue relates to winding down the VCOC. The fund must continue to pass the 50% test on each annual valuation date until it ends its distribution period, at which point different rules apply with respect to the percentage ownership of qualifying investments. There are special rules applicable to the wind down period, which we won't get into here. Next is the real estate operating company exception, REOC exception. The requirements for a REOC under the plan assets regulation are similar to those of a VCOC. To constitute a REOC, a fund must invest at least 50% of its assets valued at cost in qualifying real estate that is managed or developed. The fund must have the right to substantially participate directly in the management or development of the real estate. The REOC, in the ordinary course of its business, must be engaged directly in real estate management or development activities. Going on to the next slide, and this is perhaps the most well-known exception to the look-through rule, is the significant participation, or the under 25% test. This is the exception most commonly relied upon by hedge funds. The under 25% test provides that the underlying assets of an entity into which the plan has invested will not be considered plan assets under ERISA if the equity participation in the fund by benefit plan investors is insignificant. So to comply with this under 25% test, benefit plan investors must hold less than 25% of the value of each class, and that's important, each class of equity interests issued by the fund. It's important to note that the under 25% test applies to each class of equity individually. The DOL has not provided much clarity on what constitutes a separate class of equity for this purpose. However, a market practice has developed around this. Therefore, it's important to discuss with an ERISA practitioner what aspects of a security might cause it to be considered a separate class for purposes of the under 25% test. It's also important to note that interests held by controlling persons, other than controlling persons which are themselves benefit plan investors, will be excluded from the calculation for purposes of the under 25% test. Who are controlling persons? Individuals or entities with discretionary authority or control over the assets of the fund, for example, the general partner or a managing member of a hedge fund, those are considered controlling persons. In addition, individuals or entities who provide investment advice for free, direct or indirect for the fund, such as the investment manager for a hedge fund, will also be considered a controlling person. Further, affiliates of these individuals or entities are also excluded from the under 25% calculation. Fund managers must continually monitor the level of plan assets held by the fund in order to make sure that it complies with the under 25% test, because the calculation is made immediately after the most recent acquisition of any equity interests in the fund. And quickly, just to discuss some issues that arise when applying this under 25% test, you have the master feeder structure. This is a structuring question that applies when trying to allow extra ERISA capacity at the parent level. And this is where you'll hear ERISA practitioners discuss hardwiring, which effectively means to structure the fund so that all the money at the feeder level is invested directly into the master, and there's no discretion at the feeder level to invest directly into investments other than directly through the master. It's also important to note that although fund of funds cannot rely on the BCOC exception because the fund of funds is investing in another fund and not an operating company, it may be able to use the under 25% exception in order to be able to take ERISA money. So now that we've discussed the exceptions to the look-through rule, how to make sure your fund isn't subject to ERISA, I'm going to turn the presentation over to Steve, who's going to discuss what to do if your fund does become subject to ERISA.
Yeah, we're now going to, at the midpoint here, veer over to what does ERISA require you to do when it applies. This is Drew. We're going to talk about what a fiduciary is. We're going to talk about what the basic overall general prudence and diversification requirements are. We're going to talk about how prohibited transactions supplement those rules. And then we're going to talk about really how these rules may or may not apply in a reasonable way to funds that are subject to ERISA. And Steve, over to you.
Thanks, Drew. And so as I think the first part of the presentation sort of gave you the flavor, even not subject, trying not to be subject to ERISA in many cases takes a lot of effort. It's not just, oh, I decide not to be subject to ERISA. Depending upon the type of fund you are, particularly private funds, it takes a lot of work, particularly with BCOCs and in many cases below 25% funds. And again, slide 11 sort of gives and maps out the things that you sort of have to consider both in this and now, well, what if you say, I don't want, or I'm not able to, or I just want to bring on the fact that I'm going to be an ERISA fiduciary, either in a separately managed account or in a fund. So basically, why don't we talk a little bit about, very briefly, what it is that an ERISA fiduciary has to do. Well, first of all, they have to act as a prudent expert, which is a fairly high standard, if not the highest standard known at law generally. Care, skill, prudence, and diligence under the circumstances then prevailing, et cetera, which you can read. It does allow the concept of and the use of modern portfolio theory. And it's interesting when people ask me all the time, Steve, is this particular transaction permitted under ERISA? Is a swap permitted under ERISA? Is a Malaysian pork belly, if there is such a thing, permitted under ERISA? ERISA does not outlaw, generally speaking, any particular type of asset or any particular type of transaction. What it governs is conflicts, and what it governs is who's on the other side of the transaction and are there conflicts involved. So when you're acting as an ERISA fiduciary as an investment manager, you have a duty to act with an eye single, in the words of one very famous case, to the interest of participants and beneficiaries. And remember, coming back to some earlier points we said before, ERISA is really designed at giving unconflicted, expert, educated fiduciary decision making. That's what you're getting paid for, with a lot of emphasis on procedure. Okay, so what makes you a fiduciary? Well, number one, if you're a discretionary manager of plan assets, we talked about plan assets before, then you're a fiduciary. You're also a fiduciary if you give tailored investment advice, okay? So not general necessarily information that you broadcast about your views of the market that any Tom, Dick, or Harry may in fact, you know, come upon, but you know, the type of advice that people are relying on that's tailored to their and individualized to their individual circumstances. Now, in the last 10 years, there's been quite a discussion about the definition of being an ERISA fiduciary, at least an investment advice fiduciary. We're not going to get into that right now, except to say that there's been a lot of discussion concerning this definition, particularly as it relates to sales on the one hand and education on the one hand versus tailored advice on the other, in particular in the retail space. Keep in mind that it's very important for purposes of the analysis to determine if you're a fiduciary, where you're a fiduciary. So, for example, I think Aryeh just mentioned before that a registered mutual fund is not subject to ERISA. That's true by statute. So the XYZ mutual fund registered under the 40 Act, the Investment Company Act, whatever goes on inside there is not, in fact, subject to ERISA. But the discussions or the sales or the advice with respect to the sale or the offering of that mutual fund may rise, given the depending on the facts and circumstances, may rise to a fiduciary relationship. So even if you're not providing discretionary management over those assets, to the extent that somebody's giving tailored advice, a call to action, a recommendation that's individualized. Hey, I think this is the right fund for your individual circumstances. Maybe you're a fiduciary with respect to the advice, notwithstanding the fact that the pool of assets that you're actually offering is itself not subject to ERISA. That's a very important point and something that's been at the heart of the kind of debate over the last 10 years as to who, in fact, is an investment advice fiduciary. Okay, so a lot of what we talked about and what we talk about going forward is there's behavioral standards under ERISA, which I just sort of zoomed through, the prudent expert standard, diversification, loyalty, things of that nature. But as I alluded to before, particularly when I was talking about the scary stuff associated with violations of prohibited transactions and excise taxes and how they can add up, that's another theater of operations that makes people sort of think twice and how do you comply. So what is a prohibited transaction? Well, they come in two types. The first type is what people kind of refer to as the per se prohibited transaction. Now, here's a list on slide 20. But you'll quickly discover that it's pretty much every transaction and every service that you can think about. And it has to be a transaction or a service with a so-called party in interest or disqualified person. So the question is, what does that mean? Drew, let me turn that over to you, you know, briefly to see if you can give some light on that.
Yeah, I just want to talk very, very briefly on this point because I think it's actually maybe one of the biggest points. The general rules that Steve was just going over, sort of the general prudence, non-negligence type things, the deference to the fiduciary who engages in a proper process, that is considered to be a very positive approach that Congress took with ERISA. People really like that, giving it over to the experts as to what to do. When it comes to these per se prohibited transactions, these related party transactions, these tend to be, again, getting back to something I said at the beginning, really tinged with a little bit of overbreath. And where the overbreath comes in is that what the rules say is that if you're a related party, you can't do a transaction with a pension plan, with a pension or other employee benefit plan, unless there's an exemption. And the definition of related party, party in interest or disqualified person under the tax code, party in interest under ERISA, has some things you might expect. And let's just focus on one, the plan sponsor. Right, the plan sponsor is a related party, and you would not be surprised by that. The treasurer of the plan sponsor, the employer, the company, might be representing the company's interests, and then also might be representing the plan's interests. And how do you trust that individual to be on both sides? And so that's not surprising that you might need an exemption in that case. But what they do here, and this is where ERISA goes very far, they lump into these rules and they consider a party in interest a mere service provider, a mere provider of services, even like brokerage services, to a plan. And what that has the effect of doing is capturing, especially with a consolidated financial services industry, it essentially captures almost every major financial services player with respect to almost every major plan. The result being that what had been sort of a laser shot provision that you can't deal with a related party sort of gets converted into a provision that says you can't deal with a financial institution unless you have an exemption. And that's why financial institutions so frequently seek these exemptions, because they're worried that they may be parties in interest or disqualified persons to virtually every plan. And in fact, they basically assume as much. Steve, with that overview, back to you.
Sure, thanks very much. So again, as we were just saying, there's really two types of prohibited transactions. The ones that we just talked about, we'll pick up again in a moment, are the ones that may not be obvious. Transactions with unrelated parties, a bank, a broker-dealer, somebody who's not the investment manager, has no relationship to the investment manager, has no relationship to the client, but the fact that they're providing services puts them into the soup and for which you need an exemption. The next category is some prohibited transactions that you probably would or should intuit, which are kind of the self-dealing prohibited transactions. There are three types. The first is that a fiduciary, again, an investment manager or an investment advisor being paid a fee for tailored advice, using plan assets for its own account. What's a good example of that? A principal transaction. Representing both sides of a transaction or representing two parties that might, in fact, have adversity. cross-trading is a good example in many instances in that situation. The third are, well, for lack of a better term, kickbacks, receipt of consideration from third parties for your own account. Again, you recommend somebody else's fund, even if you think it's for the best interest of the client. You're acting in their best interest, but you nonetheless get a payment or a kickback. So this comes up in many, many different ways. Some of them are pretty easy. Somebody tells you, you know, look, hey, you stole my funds and I get a kickback, you ought to run the other way. But there's other areas where this can come up, and sometimes there are potential traps for the unwary. I'll just go through a couple of them. Sometimes there's issues on fees and fee structures. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But realized and unrealized gains can sometimes present challenges, particularly for private equity and what I call kind of chunky asset portfolios, which is one of the reasons, by the way, many private equity funds and real estate funds decide not to be plan assets because the fee structure is very difficult to operate under ERISA. Investments in affiliated products and services. Can you invest in your own mutual fund? Can you invest in your own collective investment fund? Well, it just so happens that there are exemptions that are available, but they're available in certain types, certain situations, and not in others. The use of affiliated service providers. Well, can I use my affiliate to execute brokerage transactions if I have an affiliated broker? Maybe yes, maybe no. Maybe yes for securities, but maybe not for futures, depending upon the exemption. The Department of Labor has gotten a lot of, put a lot of attention into the receipt of non-monetary compensation, gifts and entertainment, for example. And it's not just, you know, the yacht trip, or God forbid, somebody actually gets a yacht from, you know, somebody. We're talking about things that are ordinary course that could get you into trouble. Again, it depends on, as with everything, kind of the constellation of facts and circumstances. And I think that, different people have different approaches to this, but keep in mind, gifts and entertainment could mean attendance at different conferences, what goes on at those conferences, et cetera, et cetera. And I mentioned before, in terms of certain exemptions, there's an exemption for investing in your own open-ended mutual fund, investment in your own affiliated bank collective trust fund, et cetera. Okay. Now, the Department of Labor grants exemptions. They grant exemptions, and there are congressional or statutory exemptions. So this is a chart that sort of goes through the different types of exemptions that can be issued. At the end of the day, while this is important, it's the last column that's the most important. What is the, in my view at least, what's the exemption for? Is the exemption for the per se prohibited transactions? Is it for the self-dealing prohibited transactions? Can it be for both? And is the relief just for a specified transaction? For example, some exemptions are limited to a certain type of transaction, like, for example, buying and selling securities with a broker-dealer, a U.S. registered broker-dealer, or a U.S. bank. Now, that covers the purchase and sale of the security, but it may not cover to the extent there's an extension of credit in the security itself. Or can it cover a broad variety of transactions? And in particular, in the per se prohibited transactions, there are a number of common prohibited transaction exemptions, which are listed here. These are the most commonly used, which are not limited to a specific type of transaction. They can be effective for buying and selling securities with a U.S. registered broker-dealer or a bank, or the foreign broker-dealer or a bank. And they're not necessarily limited to securities. They can apply to futures. They can apply to commodities. They can apply to swaps. With some exceptions, they're much more broad and are usually preferred because they give the manager flexibility in knowing that it has a prohibited transaction exemption available, and it gives comfort to the sell side or counterparties with whom you're dealing that they don't have to worry about the existence of a per se prohibited transaction. So with that, you know, Aryeh, why don't you talk a little bit about one of the, I think, big five exemptions, the one that I think is most commonly used for investment managers, the so-called TPAM exemption, or PTCE 84-14.
Thanks, Steve. Sure, I'm going to advance the slide. And we're going to focus for a moment on the QPAM exemption. So the QPAM exemption was granted by the Department of Labor based on the premise that relief from the prohibited transaction rules should be made available where the transaction is the sole responsibility of an independent discretionary investment manager. And it's important, as we'll see in a moment, that the manager actually be independent. The QPAM exemption provides relief with respect to transactions between the QPAM and a party in interest, except where the QPAM is on the other side of the transaction or where the party in interest has the power to influence the QPAM. There are certain capital qualifications that a QPAM has to meet, and those are listed here on this slide 26, and discusses the different types of capitalization requirements for different types of entities that are seeking to be a QPAM. And generally, a plan fiduciary will require that the investment manager provide a representation in the investment management agreement, the IMA, indicating and representing that the investment manager will qualify as a QPAM. Now, in addition to the capital requirements, the QPAM needs to acknowledge in writing that it is a fiduciary, and the terms of the transaction need to be negotiated by the QPAM or pursuant to the QPAM's authority and direction. It's important that the QPAM is the entity that's directing the process, because the whole point of the exemption is that we're relying on the QPAM's independence and discretion in order to be eligible for this exemption. Another requirement of the QPAM exemption is that the terms of the transaction that the QPAM is entering into on behalf of the plan must be at least as favorable to the plan, as the terms that are generally available in an arm's length transaction between unrelated parties. Importantly, because we are relying on the QPAM to be a responsible fiduciary, in order to qualify as a QPAM, neither the QPAM nor any of its affiliates can have been convicted of certain crimes, and those are generally financial-related crimes, within the 10-year period prior to the transaction. This, of course, is super important, because if the affiliate of an advisor is convicted of a crime, an investment advisor can lose its entire fiduciary business, as has been seen in the industry. As I mentioned, an important part of the QPAM exemption is that a QPAM not be influenced by outside parties to engage in the transaction. Therefore, there are specific carve-outs from the QPAM exemption for transactions involving one of the following situations. And they're pointed out here on the slide. Number one, the party in interest or one of its affiliates has the authority to appoint or terminate the QPAM, which is referred to as the hire or fire ability, or to negotiate the terms of the management agreement with the QPAM. Another carve-out to the QPAM exemption is a scenario where the party in interest has assets that are managed by the QPAM, even where those assets aren't the ones that are involved in the transaction, where such assets make up more than 20% of the assets managed by the QPAM generally. And finally, a carve-out where the QPAM or one of its affiliates is on the other side of the transaction. And I believe Steve is going to take it from here.
Thanks, Aryeh. Yeah, that was great. Go ahead, Lindsay. I'm sorry.
Sorry, Steve. Yeah, I was just wondering, definitely as we're coming into the last minutes here, performance fees, incentive fees, and fee structures generally on plan assets funds have caused a number of issues in my practice for sure, and consternation on what you actually can do. So can you make sure to cover some of those in this discussion?
Sure. Thanks, Lindsay. I alluded to this earlier, and it's sort of a sleeper issue for the unacquainted with ERISA. Again, the question under ERISA is whether you are using your authority as a fiduciary to put it crudely, lining your pockets. Are you using your discretion in any way to basically get a higher fee? That can come in a variety of different flavors. For example, are you determining what the valuation is of the underlying positions? Are you deciding when to realize certain positions? So is it a realization-based fee as opposed to an NAV, a private equity or real estate distressed debt type of fee structure, as opposed to a strict kind of hedge fund NAV year-over-year, you know, return? These things sort of matter because ERISA generally, at least with respect to incentive fees, looks very down on the situation where a manager is able to sort of either time the realization of its fee, or it's able to sort of use its discretion to, in fact, determine the fee. So in my experience, those that are sort of in a hedge fund NAV model, where things are taken on a yearly basis based on NAV, which takes account of both realized and unrealized gains and losses, those are usually easier to deal with under ERISA. Now, again, you've got considerations associated with, making sure that all of your inputs are things that you're not necessarily determining. Now, obviously, if it's a portfolio of publicly traded securities, that's usually not going to be difficult. But where things are illiquid or they're traded in foreign markets where the transparency may not be as great as people would like, but some people sometimes run into issues there. The bigger concerns often relate to, as I've sort of alluded to, the realization-based models where, private equity, real estate, other kind of, chunky assets, I get paid when you get paid, or you get paid when I get paid, essentially, which raises the issue about, well, do I have an incentive to time when it is that I'm actually getting paid? And while there are different structures and strategies for some of those funds to take into account, many times those funds, for a variety of reasons, including some of the other self-dealing concerns that we articulated before, oftentimes just do not go down the path of, in fact, becoming plan assets because it's a big driving factor as to whether the fees work or don't work. Do not take away from this that it is impossible to structure a fee that works, even if it's realization-based. It's just that it's enormously more complicated, and like everything with an ERISA, it's not what works perfectly well in other commercially reasonable arm's-length transactions. In fact, what investors usually want doesn't necessarily correspond to what ERISA demands. So with that, let me go on to just a couple of other quick topics. Keep in mind there's also a separate regime of restrictions on buying or holding employer securities. The question often comes up, well, how do I know when I'm dealing with an employer security? What if the employer has different affiliates? Are there securities that I can't buy? Who's going to tell me? Who's responsible for that? What about affiliates? There are various ways that people deal with this issue in the fund context and separate account context, but just to make sure it's on everybody's radar. Two other issues, one which I think is probably the most difficult to sort of explain, is the fact that the assets of plan assets, ERISA assets, have to be held in the United States. The indicia of ownership of those assets has to be held in the United States, absent an exception. Think about a rule that is prehistoric and has not adapted with either the dot-com or the last 20 years, and you're looking at a regulation that is the indicia of ownership regulation, which is to say, if you're dealing with securities, foreign securities, and you're a U.S. manager, generally speaking, you're probably going to be able to comply with these rules. But if you're a foreign manager with no nexus to the United States whatsoever, there's a lot of difficulty in making sure that these rules apply and are satisfied. That doesn't mean, again, that it's impossible to. There's a variety of different strategies and things to do, but it is something that comes up quite often. And so as you think as an ERISA fiduciary, there's a list of things that I need to comply with and make sure I get. I have to comply with my fiduciary duties. I have to make sure there aren't, prohibited transactions and make sure that I don't knowingly or should knowingly engage in a prohibited transaction. I have to make sure that I'm, not dealing with employer securities in an appropriate fashion. I need to know that my fee structure works appropriately. And now I have to deal with indicia of ownership concerns, and I may have to be bonded under Section 412 of ERISA, which says basically if I'm handling plan assets, which for this purpose in a plan asset fund means if I'm managing it, then I have to be bonded by certain amounts. Bonded, by the way, for this purpose doesn't mean bonded like for other than just because, the whole point of this is to be protect the plan against the loss by reasons of act of fraud or dishonesty. It's a statutory prescription. It's not intended to be, a bond, you get it back. It's really sort of a Listen, if you're a fiduciary and you're handling plan assets, this is a statutory requirement assured and designed to effectively make sure that you don't, kind of go run away and take the assets. True, I think there's another issue that I know you wanted to talk about briefly before we talk about a couple of recently breaking developments on exculpation. So I'm going to turn it over to you for a sec.
Yeah, and you mentioned bonding. Bonding is not fiduciary insurance, not sort of the typical D&O fiduciary insurance. Bonding is there to protect a participant who has been essentially stolen from. Fiduciary insurance is something that protects the fiduciary. And on that point, I think it's important for a fiduciary to understand the fiduciary's potential liability under ERISA. You basically have the prudence standard that Steve talked about early on, the basically negligence. What you often see in commercial settings is a lot of managers saying, hey, look, I'm not liable to you unless I'm grossly negligent. That's the deal. My fee structure is structured so that I'm basically only going to worry about gross negligence. I'm not going to worry about mere negligence. Important point here, ERISA does not permit you that to disclaim liability for a violation of fiduciary duties. If you're negligent, you're liable. And that is a difference from what you might see in other commercial settings. You can get insurance to cover the additional risk where maybe you're merely negligent and you wish you weren't liable there, but you are. You can maybe get insurance out of your own pocket for that, paying for the premiums out of your own pocket. But importantly, you cannot run away from the ERISA standard of care by contract. I just want to get that point out there. Steve, back to you.
Thanks, Drew, very much. In wrapping this up, at least in terms of the materials we wanted to talk about today, we did want to mention that there are two regulatory initiatives by the Department of Labor that have caught a lot of people's attention. In particular, the Department of Labor has issued a regulation that may affect the use of ESG, environmental, social, and governance factors in terms of investment management. We've written a fairly comprehensive discussion about what this regulation is. Suffice it to say that we expect that this regulation, in fact, will be finalized before the election. Query what happens after the election. But bottom line, it's fair to say the Department of Labor has expressed a significant amount of skepticism that the use of ancillary consideration really can increase investment performance. Over past administrations, people have sort of moved, up and down around the margins. This administration's come out pretty strong. And they really effectively, I think it's fair to say, they really are looking to limit the consideration of social goals. The end of the day, I think the regulation is a final matter. Will really make it harder for plans to choose ESG-centered or ESG-focused investments. It may or may not have as much of an impact, depending upon how things develop, for those funds and strategies that you use ESG as, maybe one among many different factors that are considered. Clearly, Europe is moving in the other direction. I think it's noteworthy to consider this. In addition, sort of its companion piece is the proposed proxy regulation, where the Department of Labor issued proposed proscriptions and prescriptions. The department speaks of must vote and must not vote. It also discusses how and where you can use proxy advisor firms and the use of even investor managers and their interactions with clients and how proxy voting can be affected. Again, this is part of the late breaking in the sense that this is the second half of 2020 regulations that have been proposed, very short time for comments. And in fact, we're expecting probably, we can't promise, but we're expecting some sort of final regulations out soon, just given the signals that we've been hearing from Washington. Obviously, that's a best guess, not a promise. So with all of that, Lindsay, I don't know, or Drew or Aryeh, if you had any specific thoughts.
Just on the ESG thing, we'll post. Steve mentioned that we have some written items on the ESG developments. We'll post them on the website in addition to what's already posted there. After the session's over. And Lindsay, why don't we leave it to you for any closing thoughts?
Sure. So thank you very much to the three of you for giving us that overview. I certainly know that, you know, ERISA is something that crops up a lot in practice, and so it's really good to have teammates that really know what they're doing. Thank you very much to everyone for attending today, and we look forward to seeing you at the next Private Funds Nuts and Bolts webinar. And if you have any follow-up questions, Drew, Aryeh, and Steve, information is included on the slide as well as mine. So we look forward to seeing you soon. Thank you.
Thank you.